Right, hello. Well, welcome back to the second of these essential bite-sized mini presentations, about 12 to 15 minutes, something like that. The second topic that I've taken for today is gamification. Gamification is a term that's widely used, often not entirely accurately. And I want to begin by quickly disambiguating two related terms. These two terms are gamification and game-based learning. Game-based learning is when the learning activity is kind of disguised as a game. And examples of this are Kahoot and Wordwall, where you know you have little quizzes or games, or you spin a wheel or whatever it might be, and the learning activity is disguised as a game. There may be elements of gamification in this, and there's a crossover between the two. But what I'm not talking about at all in this little session is game-based learning. I'm talking about gamification, rather different. One of the crossovers between them is that the point of both is fundamentally concerned with motivation. Motivation is the reason why game-based learning is used, and it's also the reason why gamification is used. And both of them are kind of becoming more important with the rise of blended online self-study. Teachers have long used both games in the classroom. Some of the most popular books over the years have been games like communication games in English, or some of the photocopiables that accompany the course books, game-like things, where you cut up the bits of paper and learn to share it. So we've long used games to motivate students, and we've long used elements of games, rewards. You often, when you're observing classes or you hear about classes, you hear about very obvious rewards where young children are given sweets, for example. But this whole idea of rewards is a fundamental part of gamification, and that's what I want to explore a little further. So, when we're talking about gamification, the most common elements of gamification is that as a learner is involved in an activity, much in the same way as they're involved when they're playing a game online, a video game of some kind, is that they get points and they get badges, and there are leaderboards which compare who's got the most points or the fewest points. And the example on the right of the screen here, I just need to move my own little window so I can see it better. The example on the right of the screen is me using the Memorize vocabulary app, and that's my current point total, and there's a leaderboard showing that there's a couple of people in front of me. The fact that I'm at the top of this leaderboard means that I've been spending an awful lot of time on it. And the idea of the leaderboard, of course, is that I should be motivated to try to get to the top. And I need to really spend quite a lot more hours to get beyond this other person, Guyen Duy, I can't pronounce it, I'm afraid, to get there. So these are the motivational tricks and tools of the trade in gamification. There are, in addition to the points and badges and leaderboards, sometimes there are levels and you get to the next level, like in any game. There may also be graphs, which will measure your progress over a particular period of time. So you start getting, let's say, 20 points a week, and then the next week you went down to 12 points, or whatever it might be. Graphs that will measure the amount of time that you've spent playing the game or doing whatever it is you're supposed to do. And again, these graphs are intended to help you make even more progress. You may also be receiving personalized emails. These emails are often things like, you have spent 27 minutes this week doing this. Try to break your record by going further. Or it might be a personalized email saying something like, make sure you find some time to do your work this week or you will lose your streak, this kind of thing. Anyone who's played games will be familiar with these kinds of messages. There may be other kinds of rewards too. I mean, in many games now, one of the most significant rewards is you're playing with an avatar, a little sort of animated figure that represents you in the game. And the more you play, the more you get points, and then you can use these points to change the outfit of your avatar. A game that I've been looking at a little bit recently is a game called PKXD, which is a game for children about 10 years old, that kind of thing. And the appeal of many children is that they can actually change the appearance of their avatar, or they can change the room that they're playing in or the world that they're exploring. So that's a very common reward in all gamification systems. And one more, which I would just mention again briefly, is the unlocking of special features. In one of the apps that I was involved in developing a few years ago, it was a vocabulary app, all based around the theme of football. When learners achieved a certain level or they got certain points, they could unlock a special feature. And this special feature, in this case, was a little video clip showing some wonderful goal scored by Mbappe or somebody like that, or Haaland, I don't know. So there's a very short reward, which in this case was a video clip. There could be all sorts of other special features that can be unlocked in this way. Again, the point of it all is to enhance motivation. Some of these things can be done in a classroom, concretely, but mostly this is going to be done online. An example of the kind of information that you get is on the screen here, where you get the full range of gamification features. Now, when it comes to gamification, since the whole point of is motivation, the question that the game designer has to come up with is, what is it exactly that we want to reward? Almost always, all of these systems will reward you for simply spending a lot of time playing with the system, time on the task. So even if you're getting things wrong on a regular basis, you'll still almost certainly be getting some points and moving up through some levels just by spending a lot of time doing it. There'll also be some kind of, typically, there'll be some kind of recognition of how well you do it. So there'll be a point score awarded for how many answers you get right or wrong, your performance on the task. Also, typically factored in is some kind of recognition of your own personal goals. So before you start a system, let's say a vocabulary app or any other gamified language learning tool, you'll typically be asked, what are your personal goals? How many minutes do you want to spend a day, or how many minutes do you want to spend a week, or what level do you want to achieve by the end of the month? And if you meet those personal goals, which you can adapt them along the way, if you meet those goals, then you'll get additional points or badges or avatar changes or whatever. There is also, of course, this question of how you perform relative to others. Now, a lot of teachers have very mixed feelings about this. Is competition a good motivator or not? Competition against other learners. So because there is this difference of opinion, you'll actually see systems which sometimes have this comparison of performance to others and sometimes not. What is almost always the case, however, is that there is going to be a teacher's dashboard where a whole class is practicing on a particular app or a tool. There'll be a teacher's dashboard, and this will allow the teacher to compare the performances of individual students. There is, of course, a danger here that even if the students can't see these comparisons, if they know that the teacher can see them, then this can be both a positive and a negative motivator. So it could be rewards for performance related to others. And the last one I want to mention is quite an interesting, which I've seen only on one or two apps, and these are random rewards. The idea here, the psychology behind this is that people are often more motivated when it's not entirely predictable. The relationship between your performance and the reward is not entirely predictable. So you can do, for example, your 10 minutes or 15 minutes a day that is needed, but the reward that you get for that has an aspect of randomness in it. So you might get 2 gold stars or you might get 3 gold stars. And the idea here, I suppose, is that with this element of random rewarding, you really want to do it lots and lots of times, because if you only got 1 gold star last time, maybe next time you'll get 3 gold stars. So random rewards are drawing on motivation theory, and we're beginning to see them from time to time. However, that's a kind of description of the sorts of things that we're seeing in language learning apps. And sometimes these things are done incredibly well. I mean, you know, really sophisticated graphics and sophisticated gaming systems. But there are some issues with all of this. Here are they. Not everybody is motivated by playing games. Not everybody is motivated by collecting gold stars or being able to change their avatar. Some people just find it too juvenile, and some people just find it provokes anxiety. They just don't want to be in the situation where they're under pressure to do something. So we can't assume that all learners will respond positively to gamification. There may be cultural differences here, there may be expectations, and it may even be the case that learners who do respond well to gamification may just find the gamification system on their language learning app just not very good or not very motivating. It's crap. Now, it's just not as good as the games that they're used to playing. So the issue then is one of individual differences, and it won't suit everybody. Clearly not. The second potential problem here is that it's quite easy when you're highly motivated to do something, a learning activity, is that you get a bit mixed up between whether you're actually gaming or whether you're learning. And I'm somebody who does quite enjoy points, badges, and leaderboards, and all of these rewards, and being able to get a special sword for my avatar, or whatever it might be. But I found, for example, with the Memorize system, which I used for quite a long time, that I was trying to game the system. I figured out quite quickly that the best way to get points on Memorize was to do what is called a fast test, a speed test. But the speed test is only of value, really, in learning terms, if you do it not too often. But I would do speed test after speed test after speed test and accrue lots and lots of points. So I was gaming the system, getting lots of points, trying to get to the top of my leaderboard for whatever stupid reason I may have had. But I wasn't really learning very much. And there is this problem with all gamified systems for language learning, that you may be doing too much gaming and not enough learning. This is related to my third big point, and that is the learning activity actually of a sufficient intrinsic value? Now, this is not an easy question to answer. We know, for example, that completing lots and lots of gap fills in grammar exercises is a relatively low reward, relatively low learning reward. There are better things that you could do with your time. So if you have a system which encourages you to do lots and lots of grammar gap fills, verbs in brackets, probably you'd be better off doing something else. Perhaps less questionable is the acquisition of vocabulary through deliberate study, through vocabulary flashcards. But again, there are some issues here. Learning vocabulary through flashcards is kind of okay, so long as the items that you're studying are appropriate and relevant to your needs as a learner. This means that they're going to be high frequency words. There's not a lot of point studying really, really low frequency vocabulary items, which you're never going to come across again. And the problem with so many of the apps is that the content that's programmed into them is just not very good. It's not been thought through, and it's certainly not personalized enough. In many cases, you might want to encourage learners, if the vocabulary app was good, you might want to encourage them to spend 10 minutes, something like that, 15 minutes a day. But if it really motivates them and they're spending an hour a day, they're probably wasting their time. They would do far better to spend the extra 45 minutes, let's say, watching videos on YouTube with English subtitles, watching video clips, listening to English songs, or dare I say, even reading a book. There are often better things that learners could be doing. The next and the last significant point here is these kinds of gamification tricks and techniques encourage short-term motivation, but it seems from research that they do very little to transfer to long-term motivation. So the little gamification tricks and tools may help learners initially get to use the app, but over the long term, this has to be translated to long-term motivation. And that seems to be something which gamification can't really help with. So, gamification, yes or no? Well, I think the answer here is, well, to a certain extent, it can be valuable, but we need to think quite carefully about its potential drawbacks. Perhaps more interesting, and I've taken this from a really interesting article by Paul Driver, which I strongly recommend, is that gamification draws on what we know about successful games. But you know, actually, it's not the gamification elements of games that make them really successful. In terms of the game I mentioned earlier, PKXD, this Brazilian game, it's not the gamification elements, the points and the gems that you get, that really get the kids hooked on it. There are three things that make it really powerful. The first is that they have freedom. They have freedom to do in a game what they want to do, which is rarely the case in most language learning games. Secondly, games that really work well are intrinsically motivating, and this means often that there's freedom to do different kinds of tasks. And lastly, there's always an element of social interaction. So any really popular game involves players interacting with each other. We're beginning to see this come into language learning apps, but not enough yet. So perhaps these three things are more valuable to us in terms of designing learning activities than gamification tools. That's all I have to say for the moment. Thank you very much.